So thank you very much for inviting me to this event, which is very important to IBES, since you many times mentioned the conceptions of transparency, and I guess and I believe that these events and participating in those events by MEP members or bureau members or any other members who are involved in the IBES is a great honor and a great opportunity to make IBES as transparent as possible. So I'm really happy to join you. Although, to tell the truth, I used to speak looking at people's eyes and get the immediate reactions of boredom or excitement, which gives me a better impression how the presentation goes, and now I don't have this opportunity. So forgive me if I try to be very brief and concentrate on some key issues, which I think key issues might be concerning the work program and the role of not only expert but the bureau and the MEP, because they work together. So I would like to at least make an attempt to interpret how this work started in 2014 and how it is really actualized, operationalized in practice, since already some expert groups convened and started to work, and I could enjoy one of them, so I can give you some first-hand experiences. And also next week, another task force meeting is scheduled, which I will attend. So not just expert groups, but task forces are started to work as well. So just please give me one more feedback that everything is all right and you can hear me.
Yes, no problem. We can hear you. We can hear everything you say and we can see your slides projected on the screen. So please continue.
All right. Thanks a lot. So, first of all, I think my colleagues talking before me were very kind to introduce IBES, the structure of IBES, many important goals of IBES. So I'm just really kind of reiterating some of it just to set the stage for the details. So the platform, as you all know, it's really into the science policy interface concerning biodiversity and ecosystem services and how it links to human well-being, sustainable development, and sustainable use of biodiversity. It has its set functions, operational principles, procedures, as the previous presentations highlighted, and has four objectives. Hans' presentation already introduced these four objectives, but again, it is a reiteration just to put in context the deliverables and the work program, which I am supposed to talk about it. So basically, as you could see, the four objectives is about all about science policy interface, how we can build up a better capacity and knowledge foundation for the science policy interface. That's the first objective. The second is about how we can deal with scale, the sub-regional, regional, and global levels, and address science policy interface issues at different scales, integrated. The third objective is, as I understand, is about the thematic and methodological issues on the science policy interface of biodiversity ecosystem services, and communication and evaluation what is going on in IBES as a science policy interface platform is a kind of it's a continuous function and objective. So just going into the objective, seeing that related to the objectives that are the particular deliverables, and the work program is organized according to deliverables. So all the experts nominated and selected for the IBES and the Bureau and the MAP, with the support of the IBES Secretariat, will work on reaching the objectives through working on deliverables, which for the first objective, enhancing capacity and knowledge, means four deliverables, which we should, with the experts, expert group members and task forces members who already selected, we have to produce these deliverables. The first two deliverables, it's about capacity building, what exactly IBES can and should bring into the science policy interface at the different scales, sub-regional, regional, global, in order to enhance the capacities at these specific scales for science policy interface, and how to finance it, how to catalyze financing. These are the two deliverables of these objectives are about. Capacity and Knowledge Foundation has a lot to do with the issue one of the participants already asked for, how other types of knowledge holders will be involved, or how other types of knowledge will be introduced. There is a specific deliverable under Objective 1 on designing procedures and approaches, how to work with indigenous and local knowledge systems and knowledge holders. So this is a very important differentia specifica of IBES as a global organization, that it specifically assigns deliverables which should design and make transparent procedures, processes, and the general approach, how to involve other types of knowledges, non-scientific knowledge, into the science policy interface at this global initiative. And there is the issue of all the time in the biodiversity science, the knowledge and data, how to access knowledge and data, how to build on existing knowledge and data, and how to balance or fill the knowledge gaps, and how to generate new knowledge. So this is the first very important deliverable of the work program this year, to start work on this deliverable. Objective 2 is about the scale issue, science policy interface at different scales, and here the assessments are, should be delivered, which is a guide on production and integration of assessment at different levels across scales. And there is a regional assessment or sub-regional assessment and global assessment which should be carried out. Already the previous presentation highlighted the sensitive issue of how regions are organized within IBES. I should say that this was very much debated among MAP and Bureau, and different propositions were put forward. But finally, there was no agreement on any other solutions than accepting the UN five regions and trying to organize the best work accordingly. And although some operational decisions and operational solutions can be found to initiate regional interaction, I believe this is what the different European biodiversity platforms, including the Belgian one, is doing, organizing these events and inviting non-Western, not in the VEOG region, participants. And also, when the regional the scoping assessment for the regional assessment will meet in Nairobi this August, that the decision was made that the regional scoping meetings will not be separate, but will be joint meetings in Nairobi. So all regional experts selected to contribute to regional scoping assessment will gather in Nairobi and have the chance to have separate meetings, regional refocus meetings, and interact between the regions in order to kind of enhance the possibility to take into consideration other regional issues than the UN regions. So I think this is an opportunity and a try. But let's pick up and go to the objective three and the assessments here, the thematic assessment under objective three is about pollination and pollinators as regarding food production. As you might know, this is a fast track assessment, so all the work, the major part of the work should be done this year, which means that an assessment report should be ready, not just scoping. And there are other three thematic assessments which are kind of postponed in a sense that it's not started yet: land degradation and restoration, invasive alien species, and the sustainable use and conservation of biodiversity. All these three will start in some sense this year for opening the call for nomination of experts, but I think it's already open for land degradation and restoration, and definitely will be open later for invasive alien species as well. So these assessments are not fast track, they got more time to be developed for first for scoping and then for the full assessment. And under objective three, there are two important methodological issues which should be tackled. One got a fast track status by the second plenary of IMBES. This is about scenario analysis and modeling as related to biodiversity and ecosystem services. But a highly controversial issue about the conceptualization of values and the values of nature, biodiversity and nature's benefits to people, was not accepted at the second plenary in Antalya, and that's why it was taking it out. They took it out from the fast track, and this year a scoping study, scoping for assessment, and the guide should be prepared by the expert group who were selected for this methodological assessment. I guess you imagine why was it so controversial. This is really about worldviews, a philosophical stance, how we conceptualize humans and nature, the relationship between humans and nature, and in this sense the different cultural approaches couldn't make an agreement. and this is also mirrored by the conceptual framework of IBES, which tries to integrate these different worldviews, but definitely it doesn't mean that it can stay within science as we strictly understand it, because it should involve this kind of philosophical views on human-nature relationship, which is, I believe, it is fair enough, and this is how it is, because values are about our life and most important relations. So the objective four about the communication issues, you might know that there is also already available on the IBES website a catalogue of relevant assessments. This is the responsibility of the Secretariat, not the MAP and not the Bureau. And also the responsibility of Secretariat is the 4B deliverable, preparing an information and data management plan, how all the information and data used and collected under IBES will be managed and secured and protected and shared as appropriate. The three next one concerns more the map and bureau and experts work, which is the first 4C is a catalog of policy support tools and methodologies and a guide to use policy support tools and methodologies. This expert group is already selecting and had its first meeting in Bonn 2 weeks ago, and it's already started its work under huge time pressure to produce this guide and the catalog. I can tell you more details if you think it would be interested to make more transparent the process. The communication and outreach and engagement strategies, products and processes, that's the for brief, this is the stakeholder engagement strategy, which is under preparation, which has many discussions already with stakeholders as well, in different occasions, and it will be still discussed and open for public discussion. And what you can also find in the IBES website, which might interest you, some of the MAP members produced a document on the lessons learned about the effectiveness of the platform, how it worked so far, and what kind of relations it had been established between Bureau, MAP, Secretariat, so plenary and observers, so different issues which some of are kind of debated sensitive issues that for this document might interest you. So, just to have this figure again, these are the four objectives, and the under four objectives we have the work program and the deliverables. And let's see what is happening in 2014 now. And three task forces have been selected: task force on capacity building, knowledge and data, and indigenous and local knowledge. So this selection was made in a MAP and Bureau meeting in Bonn this year, and the task force selected experts were already called to join the process, and if they accepted the invitation, they will start the work next week with the capacity building task force definitely, and they might already started the work online. Since the work is organized that they all get so-called zero draft materials about the capacity building knowledge and data and indigenous and local knowledge issues, how it is envisioned by the MAP and the Bureau, and they can openly comment it, share the comments among each other, and then in the face-to-face meetings we will discuss all the details, how to review, revise, enhance, develop these documents. Also, in 2014, scoping assessments will start. Already for the valuation, diverse conceptualization valuation, the methodological assessment, expert group was selected, and this expert group already commented the scoping, the zero draft scoping document, and the MAP and the Bureau who are involved and support this expert group are now working on integrating these expert comments, and early July there will be a meeting, expert group meeting, when face-to-face detailed discussions, interactions will happen, and a revision of the scoping document will take place. Also, other scoping for other thematic assessments will start this year. The guidance document. As to the valuation issue or the methodological assessment on diverse conceptualization of values nature provides us, there is also not just a scoping document but a guide. This is really needed in the first year, in 2014, since first year of the work program, since other assessments, other reports, almost all of them include a chapter on issues related to valuation, like the pollination fast track assessment has two chapters devoted to economic valuation and another chapter to non-economic valuation of pollination and pollinators services. So if there is no guide, then there is no integration between the different deliverables and the work under IPBES. So the guide should be ready very quickly in order to inform those experts who are involved in the pollination semantic assessment, fast track assessment, and support them. Also, this is the case with the policy support tools as a methodological assessment. All other thematic assessments and the capacity building task forces need input from the policy support expert group, how to involve and what approach to use the policy methodologies, policy support tools, how they can use in the capacity building work, how they can use it in the pollination assessment. If they want to assess the currently previously used, for example, policy support tools, how they can assess it. So this should be a guide, a methodological guide. I hope I'm kind of understandable. So, and the assessments which are ongoing, two, one thematic and one methodological, so they are not scoping documents, they are already assessments, as I already mentioned, the pollination and pollinators regarding food production, and scenarios and models on biodiversity and ecosystem services. This methodological assessment was accepted by the plenary, so it could start as a fast track and already select those experts who will write these assessments. So, let's see the roles. Although I would love to stop and ask, is there any question or for clarification or any other issues?
Is there any question from the audience so far? No, I don't see any questions, so please continue.
Okay, thanks. I hope this is not because of it is so boring. To tell the truth, I'm a lecturer at the university, so I am very concerned how I am lecturing. And I miss this interaction very much. All my students know that I can really think if they are giving feedback to me right away. So anyway, I miss this, so I continue. Now we turn to the task forces, and I try to clarify the roles of MAP, Bureau, and the selected experts. So this might be interesting to you if you want to understand how the experts can contribute or will contribute, and what is the role, exact role of the MAP and Bureau as it is envisioned right now. It seems that the Capacity Building and Knowledge Data Task Force decided that it will be chaired, co-chaired by two Bureau members, and three MAP members are included, and there is 20 selected experts who will contribute. So this is the arrangement. Bureau will chair and take the majority of or major task of facilitation, but three MAP members will be included. The ILK, the Indigenous and Local Knowledge Task Force, in contrast, are chaired by two MAP members and include the support of two Bureau members and 20 nominated and selected experts from all over the world. And it, as you could see, there are some other interesting issues. first of all, that if we couldn't make a good balance of selection among the pool of nominated experts, the MAP and Bureau considered additional MAP and Bureau members to be included in order to get the geographical balance, gender balance, or any other disciplinary issues, which we couldn't appropriately solve within the pool of experts who were nominated mostly by governments, but also by stakeholders. And also, there is an issue, since the interim MAP will end its work this end of this year. So we will resign, all of us, and the new nomination process will go on. And the issue is that, which we already experienced, you might know that Asia-Pacific decided that even for the interim MAP members, they don't want just five members for the whole 2 years. They half the years and change the members of the MAP. So we started to work with five members from Asia-Pacific at the MAP, and when we all get to know each other and started to understand the work much better, then we lost these five members and got five new ones, and we had to kind of, they had to catch up with us and had to train them how to be involved. So we are concerned in this sense that this kind of renewal of membership in one sense very advantageous because it can get new energy in, but in a sense some continuity might be needed. And therefore it is envisioned that if any bureau or MAP members who invested a lot of work, for example, in task force, in any task forces, would like to remain and continue work, even though they are not continuing as MAP or Bureau members, one can do this and can continue contribution. For the scoping, scoping for assessment and preparation for guides, it's co-chaired by MAP and three MAP and two Bureau members are involved. And mostly for this assessment, the selection of experts depends on the deliverable. So for thematic assessments, more experts are selected usually, for methodological assessment, less experts, but I will return to this by exact numbers, giving some examples at the end of the presentation. Again, we experienced problems selecting from the pool of nominated experts. Therefore, sometimes it was advantageous to use the possibility to involve more MAP and Bureau members if they have the skills to contribute to that specific thematic or methodological assessment, and of course the business. And again, this continuity issue emerged, and a similar decision was made to make possible for those, one of those MAP or Bureau members who would like to continue, even though they no longer acting as MAP or Bureau members, for contributing to these time-bound expert groups. Let's see the assessments. For the assessments, our MAP members also can be selected as co-chairs, that was a possibility, or convening lead authors and lead authors, if it is appropriate and they are qualified. But as far as it is now, for at least the pollination assessment, that was not needed. Fortunately, the pool of experts were so rich and so qualified that it was possible to have co-chairs leading, convening lead authors from that pool, and that doesn't need any additional work. Don't need any additional work from MAP members. Also, the continuity the concern that should be established if it happens that a map member is involved so deeply, thoroughly, that acting as a co-chair. So far, as I said, it's not happening. It's not the case. The bureau members are not allowed or not supported to enter into this assessment as any kind of major contributors, except in the review process. So we are counting on some of them, since some of them are have high credentials, scientific credentials. They might act as peer reviewers in the review process. The management team. There is a possibility, and also there is the need sometimes to form a management committee or a management team under an assessment. That happened with the pollination issue. Since this means that the involved MEP and bureau members, with the support of the secretariat and the co-chairs who accepted the invitation to act as co-chairs, they form this management committee and they do together the further selection of experts. So again, as you could see, from the pool of experts, co-chairs are selected first, and these co-chairs are involved in further selection process if they accept the invitation, and they form together this management. Again, this continuity issue emerged, and this is envisioned that if the deeply involved bureau and MEP members, any one of want to continue, there is a possibility for one to act towards. So, let's have some data. Maybe this is something which might be interesting for you. We had the secretariat got over 1,000 nominations, and there were not less than 300 positions to be filled for this first calls for expert nominations. And what we were doing in Bonn this year for 3 days, almost for 3 entire days, we were forming groups, breakout groups around the different deliverables where experts were nominated, and we reviewed all the nominations one by one and decided who are qualified and relevant, has relevant qualifications, scientific credentials to contribute to the different deliverables. Also, I should note here that not only scientific credentials in a very narrow sense counted, but as the whole invest process want to include other knowledge holders, we put a great emphasis to include those nominees who had other type of experience, very valued experience, relevant to the particular deliverable we were selecting for, and we included also those. So you find in task forces, in expert groups, not only scientists or experts, not only with scientific background, but with professional experience or representing very specific other types of local knowledge. This was a daunting task, I could tell you. And the selection criteria was already pre-given. So we took due care for the first round of selection to keep those from the pool of nominees who are really excellent in terms of their expertise relevant to that particular or specific deliverable. Then, usually the excellence was not a strict criteria enough, we had more experts than we could invite for the actual work. So we still had to have more selection. And then after the merit, the excellence, we focused on having regionally and disciplinary and gender-wise diverse and balanced pool of experts. So that just one particular example. It was very typical for most of the deliverables or the nominated expert that from the VIOG, Western Europe and the other groups, North America, Australia, New Zealand, relatively more nominations of experts were coming in, and definitely they had less chance to get in if we would, because we kept this regional balance. Also, gender imbalance was very clear, especially for many regions, Eastern Europe, Africa, Asia Pacific. So those regions who were more balanced gender-wise, we had a better pool for, it is not a secret, for female, because typically male were dominating the pool of nominees. So we had to prefer from those regions the female nominees in order to have kept the final balance, gender balance, as best as possible. Of course, this unfortunately it was not a 50-50 balance in terms of gender, and not always the best balance or totally equal balance regionally or disciplinary. We had to work with the pool we got. And also there was a constraint on us, as you might know, the 80-20 rule, which means that we cannot invite in a given a specific task force or expert group more experts nominated by stakeholders than 20%. So we had to balance this on the entire population of each task force, expert group. So, but definitely we couldn't kept it, and we not decided not to keep it regionally, this balance, because otherwise we couldn't select the best qualified experts. So generally the process was that we got a list of selected experts and then a reserved list of experts. If the selected expert declined, then we have a reserve pool where we can turn to. There was another issue coming up in some of the selection processes. How big the optimal size of the group should be? We were, for example, confronting this in the policy support tool expert group. We are allowed to select 40 experts, but is it possible to work intensively 40 experts in such a short period of time, which we are assigned to by the work plan? So these issues were discussed, and then I will show you some solutions, very concrete examples. Also, at the capacity building selection process, we faced to the situation that there were experts nominated typically by stakeholders. Those very knowledgeable stakeholder groups who has great expertise in the topic, but if some of them or most of them couldn't be selected for other reasons, then we created to have a possibility of list of possible resource persons. If they want to contribute and they could join on their own expenses the capacity building work, because they have this capacity building experience in different regions of the world, working for global organizations, they have the relevant expertise, although they are not selected since they didn't represent specific regions, they still can act and contribute as possible resource persons. Also, for especially the pollination and the scenario and the modeling assessments, we had to come up with a selection of co-chairs, and then together with them, selection of coordinating lead authors and review editors. Many times we find imbalances and gaps, and how we tried to overcome it was, first of all, to turn to the different breakout groups. Just to give an example, the pollination assessment lacked in the pool of the nominees. There was not enough qualified economics and non-economics experts, social scientists, who can contribute to the valuation chapters, the economic and non-economic valuation. So they turned to the valuation breakout group, who were selecting those experts who were nominated for the methodological assessment on the diverse conceptualization of values. And then we could suggest experts who were not selected for our group, expert group, but could act, given their credentials, which we reviewed, they could act very well if they accept for the pollination group. So the pollination group can invite them, although they applied for the valuation expert group. So as you could see, we tried to kind of use as much as possible those experts who took the burden to make the nomination process and not involve as much as possible. But still we experienced regional and disciplinary gaps and gender imbalances. So especially that was the case for my region, Eastern Europe. So that was the decision. Then we had to kind of find new candidates who will be endorsed by their governments if we propose their selection. So we took some efforts to recruit new candidates who again nominated by government, endorsed the government, and then we can select them. So that needed in order not to have so much imbalance in terms of gender, region, and any question for qualification?
I can see one question from the audience. There will be a little bit of delay on the answers and the questions, but we can do it.
So my name is Estelle Ballion, okay. I'm one of the Belgian Biodiversity Platform members. My question relates to how, with the constraints you had been able to also engage experts from other knowledge systems than traditional science, or whether it was impossible to do.
This is a very important question. Unfortunately, I should say that it was quite clear that we lack enough nominees from these traditional groups or people representing these experts representing these traditional groups. So we got more nominations for kind of scientists or researchers who are doing research or are engaged with these communities. So I couldn't say that we were successful due to the pool of nominees, get involved directly these knowledge holders all the time. So for example, for the valuation, methodological assessment on valuation, there was no expert nominated who directly represents this kind of other types of knowledge holders, only some researchers, but very few. So then what we did, we turned to the ILK group, the Indigenous and Local Knowledge group of those MAP members and VIRO members who are facilitating the IRCave task force, or will facilitate the IRCave task force, and ask them whether from their pool of nominees we can invite somebody or they can suggest somebody, and that's how we could try to overcome this problem. But to be honest, this is still an issue which should be taken seriously and take more effort to solve if we really want to say that we could reach out directly to those groups who are these traditional knowledge holders.
Okay.
Is this an answer to your question, Estelle?
Yes, it's an answer. And apparently people are still awake and they're still smiling at you. So if you wonder, any other question
great,
from the audience?
Thanks. So then just quickly go through very specific roles of experts. Ah, okay.
It's okay, you can continue. We can take the question afterwards.
Is there another question? Okay. So one of the questions to me when I accepted this invitation was that I should speak about the role of experts. I hope I already gave some hints what the experts' role will be. But to be very clear, the experts who were invited into the IBES process will be the so-called report co-chairs, and they will have the responsibility to oversee the preparation of a particular deliverable they are involved in. And also, as I said, through this management committee or team, they will contribute to the selection process as well, from the already selected expert pool, assigned task for being coordinating lead author, for example. Also, the experts will be the coordinating lead authors, and the coordinating lead authors manage major sections or chapters of the assessments and the deliverables. They will be also involved not just into managing these sections and chapters, but also they will be involved to contribute through the management team of the final selection of lead authors and review editors. So we would like to use their expertise as well to help us to allocate the task the best way as possible among the selected experts, because many of them know each other's work and can really assign and contribute to this assignment task. Also, lead authors and review editors will come from expert group. And what is important that the lead authors will produce the designated chapter, so they will write and coordinate some of the writing tasks if it is in one chapter of the other authors. The review editors' tasks are very important also. So experts who will be selected as review editors, they will assist us, the MAP, to identify outside reviewers who will act two reviewers by chapter in for each deliverable to peer review the deliverables. So there will be non-IBES selected experts who will act also as peer reviewers in the process, if I am clear enough. And these review editors will submit related to each deliverable review reports. They will collect these independent peer reviewers, outside peer reviewers' view on the chapters and the whole deliverable, and report it to the MAP. And according to this report, definitely will the MAP and the review editors and the co-chairs, coordinating lead authors, and so on, decide how to rewrite, if it's necessary, any of the deliverables. So they have, I mean, the majority of the writing and coordination task will be on the expert selected. So the MAP and Bureau is for facilitating the process, as far as I understand our role, and try to keep all the transparency of the process. And here is the management committee or team I already mentioned many times, the Bureau, MAP, Secretariat, and the report co-chairs. They will form it and act. So these are the major roles of experts in terms of their work. And there is some guide for experts which might interest you, but I won't take much time for the details. But it is important to claim that they are appointed in their personal capacities. So they are not representing any kind of institution, not supposed to represent any kind of views except their personal scientific credentials and views and approaches and capacities. And they are expected to contribute substantively, I should say, not only to the deliverables, but to the whole process, the meetings which are taking place face to face, that's through teleconferences and so on. So they are really taken up a huge responsibility. Attend scheduled meetings, different types. Their estimated time commitment so far, but let's see what will happen in reality this year, will be 1-3 face-to-face meetings per year and an additional time to, in between meetings, working on the specific documents assigned to them. So that's quite a load of time. And also the duration of their appointment as experts is time-bound. It depends on the specific deliverable. For some, like the pollination, it might be 1 year. For others, like the capacity building task force, it can last for the entire work program period. Now I take some examples which how the selection process was done, just to give you kind of more transparency and maybe more questions and issues to be discussed and suggestions from you to us how to continue our work. So, for example, for the capacity building task force, we had got 89 nominations, and we had to select 20 experts out of this. And we also had to create a reserve list in order to be assured that if anyone who selected for the 20 will decline, we can immediately turn to the most qualified ones. Also here, from organizations who nominated experts but were not selected, like the UNDP and many MEAs nominated, multilateral environmental agreements nominated experts, we made the possibility for them to act as resource persons, as I already mentioned, if we saw that in the nomination document they could be judged as qualified very much to act as resource persons, help the capacity building work. Maybe just about the capacity building work, just as I said, next week we will have the first task force meeting in Trondheim, and you might be interested that there is a possibility not used for all the deliverables to support the IPBES process, acting as a so-called technical support unit, and Norway offered in Trondheim, a technical support unit established, which will host the task force group meeting and help all the way through carrying out the capacity building work plan in this period, the 5 years. So Norway will set these resources and support the capacity building task force experts to carry out their tasks. Also, the capacity building, one of the deliverables concerns raising more funds So in September, there will be a so-called matchmaking facility meeting, which will help to gather some experts to elaborate on the idea of how to kind of operationalize matchmaking. What is a matchmaking facility best suited to invest in order to raise funds? So there will be also later on a forum for fundraising and any other contributions. That will be the capacity building task force major task to carry out this year to develop the way how to organize these meetings in the best way and how to organize also or operationalize the capacity building needs, collect the capacity building needs of the different regions and how to operationalize within IBES processes and procedures that these needs will be answered. So what kind of processes are needed? It should be designed by these 20 experts supported by the Norwegian TSU, Technical Support Unit, MEP and Bureau members and the Secretary. And I took this capacity building as an example because I have, maybe it would have been better if I say it at the very beginning, that the tasks are so daunting front of for us as MEP members that we couldn't be involved, we could not be involved in every expert group or task forces. So we divided us ourselves, and I was only involved in capacity building, valuation, and the policy support tool so far. And that's why my first-hand experience are coming from this work. So I share you with the valuation. This controversial methodological assessment. We got 225 nominations, which is a huge number. Maybe that was the highest number compared to the experts possible to select, which is 40. And we were successful to select 37 in order to keep the regional balance. You could see that 144 were government nominated, 81 were stakeholder nominated. Within the government nominated, male experts were dominating, 110, female experts, 31. Stakeholder nominations also had this gender imbalance. So these numbers can tell you a bit, maybe, or get a hint what we were struggling with. So many qualified nominations, very few experts be able to select, many, relatively a lot stakeholder selection, but we had to keep the 80-20 balance ratio. And as you could see, a gender imbalance, huge, I would say, gender imbalance, especially for government nominations, which made our life very difficult to fulfill our wishes. It should be at least 50-50, but as you might suggest, sense, it sometimes it's not possible, given this pool of diversity of the pool of the nominees. We created also a reserve list, and that's why we selected only 37, because Eastern Europe, we couldn't even select the number of which you needed in order to keep the geographic balance. So we had to get out a new call for nomination for specifically Eastern Europe to get new nominees, qualified experts. And I can tell you here, we were very careful to get those imbalances right, which were experienced, so like gender imbalance. So we were only nominating, getting new nominations from females, experts, and you see Eastern Europe got this special possibility in order to fulfill our the expectation towards us that we have to regionally develop. And lastly, the policy support tools expert group, which already convened in Bonn, which I participated, we selected out of more, bit more than 100 nominations, 40 experts and 13 other experts for review or for the reserve list. And here the decision was made that we have to halve the group for a 20 core group of experts and the 20 larger group. This decision should be made because IBES still lacks some of the resources to finance the meetings and the work, and also in order to make the group work more effective. Working with 40 with under time pressure within 3 days, it's a very difficult task. So we decided that 20 will be selected as a core group who will attend face-to-face meetings and lead the preparation of the guide and the catalog, which should be delivered under the policy support tools assessment. And the other 20 and the 13 from the reserve list will act as reviewers throughout the process. So they will immediately enter into the process when this 20 from the core group produces written drafts of the guide and the catalog, which already started during the meeting, and we ended the meeting dividing the further tasks of writing assignments and coordinating the writing. So, as a first-hand experience, I can tell that I can share you that I enjoyed very much the first policy support tools expert group meeting. The experts were excellent. Very friendly, very collaborative, very cooperative, and very constructive all day long, despite of the fact that they are under huge time pressure to produce, which they also kind of registered that this is an almost task impossible, but definitely they do their best and use the other larger group of experts to immediately enter into as reviewers as any drafts are produced, so speed up the process of producing quality materials. So, this is how my first-hand experiences go, and just to have the pollination assessment, just some data, because this is the test track assessment, which has to be produced from the thematic assessment at the earliest date. Here, 75 authors and 12 review editors had to be selected. Finally, the selection was done, and also the selection for co-chairs were done, although two co-chairs who were invited declined, but fortunately the other two who were invited accepted. So as you can see, it is not evident that who were nominated and qualify for acting for different roles, they will immediately accept the invitation. So also we have to be very prepared how to solve the situation when there are declining responses. Gender, geographic and disciplinary gaps here were also identified, and we tried to help out each other from the disciplinary groups, but it still seems that here also needs some new calls for African experts or European experts specifically. Already the management committee could be formed since two co-chairs accepted the invitation, so they can finalize the list of coordinating lead authors, and I guess they are in the process now. I'm not involved personally, but I guess they are in the process now. They should be to have the coordinating lead authors at that. All this information, who are the co-chairs, coordinating lead authors, will be absolutely public and open on the website of IBES, but I guess until now, not it's not there yet because the process is ongoing. So, also we use the co-chairs and let's say instrumental word use and coordinating lead author to help us out to balance the identified gaps. So even experts can help us to have the disciplinary gender and geographic balance. So we count on them. And of course, we had to request the government to endorse all these nominations, new nominations. And how this is done, the management committee and the coordinating lead authors together will make the final decisions on the lead authors, authors, review editors. So it is, in this sense, a kind of very, I would say, participatory process as far as the experts concerned. So that was it.